obtained is V is a function of pi 2 comma pi 3 or V by root of 2gh. Now I can write 2gh because multiplying by 2 with pi 1 doesn't affect characteristics. A function of pi 2 is d by h, pi 3 is mu by rho vh into pi 1, or simply mu by rho vh. Pi 1 is a dimensionless number. So like this, this solution can be proved. So we have solved 6 examples here. The remaining part of dimension analysis, which is dimensionless number, will continue along with the beginning of unit 5, or at the beginning part of unit 5, which will be on the Tuesday's class, that is class number 7. So right now we'll conclude with unit 4 or today's class. In this chapter we have discussed flow through pipes, 3 classes, and the next 3 classes were on dimension analysis, where we discussed both Rayleigh's method and Buckingham's pi theorem. So the last 10 minutes discussion on unit 4 I'll do at the beginning of unit 5, and then we'll proceed with laminar flow and viscous effects. So let's conclude.
Good afternoon, everyone. So we'll be taking up the next problem, probably the last problem of this unit, because we have covered all the different types of cams. The only one which was remaining is the oscillating type of follower. So I'll dictate the problem, and as well as I'll write down the important given data. Draw the cam profile for the following details. Okay, draw the cam profile for the following details. The first one is minimum radius of cam. So we call it as base circle radius. It is given as 30 mm radius of roller ten mm, length of follower arm it is given as 45 mm, length of the follower arm is given as 45 mm. The distance from fulcrum center to can center, this is given as 55 mm. Theta naught, that is angle of rise, this is given as 80 degrees. So it is moving with SHM, followed by the dwell stroke, that is of 50 degrees, and at the end there is a return stroke of 100 degrees with let us take uniform velocity. And one more data they have given is angle of oscillation. Angle of oscillation, this is given as 30 degrees. Okay, so this is the given data. It's correct. So nowhere in the problem statement they have mentioned that it is a oscillating type of follower, but the moment they give you the follower arm and angle of oscillation, then it is to be understood that it is a oscillating type of follower. Now before I start the problem, let me just give a very rough idea of what exactly this oscillation follower is. Okay. So let me take this particular cam which is rotating in anti-clockwise direction. And it is having a roller follower in this fashion. Okay. So now what happens when the cam will rotate in anti-clockwise direction, because of this particular cam profile, this follower will tend to move in up direction, that is upward direction, or it's also called as a rise stroke. And further, when the radius gets reduced, it will also tend to move in the downward direction. So for overall rotation of this cam, the follower will keep on moving up and down, or in other words, it will reciprocate. So that's why it's called as reciprocating follower. But if I slightly modify the position of this follower, that is, instead of this arm going in the upward direction, if I draw the arm in sideways, okay, and pivot this particular point, so it is pinned at this particular point. If it is pinned, means it can rotate about the z-axis. So now what will happen? When the cam starts rotating, the follower will tend to move in the upward direction, that is, let me use a different color here. So in the upward position, it will be something like this. Okay. Once again, when the follower further rotates, when the cam rotates, it will come down. So here, as the cam keeps on rotating, we can see that the follower, which is roller in nature, it will keep on oscillating between this point to this point. Okay? And the angle with which it will move up and down, this is nothing but what they have given to us as angle of oscillation is 30 degrees. So we have been given this dimension 30 degrees. The angle of oscillation of a follower is 30 degrees. What else they have given? They have given us the length of follower arm as 45 mm. That means this length from this point to this point, this is 45 mm. This is what they have given. And there is one more parameter. Fulcrum center, the distance from fulcrum center to cam center is 55 mm. Here, this is known as fulcrum center. This is known as fulcrum center. And this point is known as cam center. So the distance between fulcrum center and cam center is given to us as 55 mm. So which means this line is having a distance of 55 mm. Okay. Now we are supposed to draw the cam profile for this particular given data here. What we can notice compared to the earlier problems is one particular data is missing, that is lift, or which we denoted as H. This is not known to us. What I'm talking about is this distance. This is H, that is what is the maximum lift of the follower in terms of linear dimension. So if I take it linearly, that is nothing but H, which is not known to us, and unless we come to know the value of H, we cannot proceed with the drawing of displacement diagram. So the first step would be to calculate what is the value of H. Okay. So if I consider this triangle, wherein this is value of H, this is 45 and this is 30 degrees. So if I want to find out H, we know that if you consider this as arc, and if the angle is small, the length of the arc and length of this vertical straight line will be approximately equal, and that length H is given as R sine theta, where R is nothing but radius of rotation. So radius of rotation would be this 45 mm multiplied by sine 30. Okay. Now, for smaller angles, we write H equal to R. Sine of any smaller angle will be equal to that angle. So instead of sine theta, you can directly write it as theta, R theta, for smaller angles. Okay, if it is less than 40 or 45 degrees, then you can go with R theta only. So in this case, the answer would be 45 multiplied by how much? Now theta, you cannot take it as 30, because on LHS, I want H, whose unit is in mm, and on RHS, I cannot get it in terms of degrees. So I need to convert this into radians. So this will be 30 into pi upon 180. And if you solve this, I think the answer, yes, it is 23.6 mm. Okay. So this is how you are supposed to calculate H. This is a basic, simple mathematical equation. The length of arc is given by R sine theta or R theta for smaller angles. That is what I have used. The length of arc or the vertical length are approximately same. So hence h is equal to r sin theta. For smaller angles it is h is equal to r theta. Theta I have converted into radians to balance the units. Okay, so answer I am getting it as 23.6. So now we know the unknown data over here, which I'll be writing at the top here. The value of h, we have got it as 23.6 mm. Okay, now once I know the value of h, I can proceed with drawing the displacement diagram. We will not spend much time on a displacement diagram, as that will remain same for all the problems. The concept and the procedure of drawing will not change. It will remain same. So I've drawn a rectangle whose height will be equal to h, which we have got it as 23.6 mm, and width as usual we have converted that 360 degrees of rotation into appropriate length. So the marking of rise stroke, dwell stroke and return stroke has to be done. Rise stroke is for 80 degrees, so either 8 centimeters, or if you are scaling down further, you can take it as 4 centimeters. So this is theta naught, which is equal to 80 degrees. Next is the dwell period, which is 50 degrees. So again, starting from here, I'll convert 50 degrees into appropriate length or suitable length. So you can take it as 5 centimeters. So theta d is equal to 50 degrees. Last is theta r. Which is given as 100 degrees, so 10 centimeters. After which there is a dwell period which I am not going to show here. That's why I am drawing a zigzag line over there. So once the marking is done, the next step is to divide them into 6 parts as we have been doing in the previous lectures. So I'll divide the rise stroke into 6 equal parts. I'll also divide the return stroke into 6 equal parts. Okay, let us number them. Starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Up to 13. In the next step, I need to draw the profile of the displacement of follower. So for a right stroke, they have told that it is as per simple harmonic motion, and for return stroke, it is uniform velocity. So for simple harmonic motion, I need to draw a semicircle on the side of this particular displacement diagram. So I'm just going to erase this dimension, and I will draw a semicircle over here for simple harmonic motion. And in the next step, we'll divide the semicircle once again into same number of parts as we have divided here. Please don't make a mistake of making 6 divisions here and 4 or 8 divisions here. Then you'll go wrong with the intersection points. So if we have made 6 divisions here, I'll also ensure that there are 6 divisions on the semicircle. And start numbering them, starting with A, B, C, D, E, and last one is F. Okay. The next step, I will draw a horizontal line from A until it intersects line number 1. I'll draw a horizontal line from B until it intersects line number 2. Similarly, a horizontal line from C until it intersects line number 3 and so on. Okay. So, we have got the intersection points. I'll just highlight them, starting with 0. Then the first line, it has intersected here, second line over here, and at the end it will be at the top. So I'll just name them, starting with first one P1, for second line it is P2, P3, P4, P5, P6. We'll join them with a smooth curve. Okay. After this, there is a dwell period. During the dwell period, the follower neither rises nor it comes down, nor it is oscillating also. Hence, P7 will be exactly horizontal over here, and the line will be continued. Now we have reached the return stroke. Again, it is with uniform velocity. As you can see, return stroke for 100 degrees, uniform velocity. And the procedure to draw the profile for uniform velocity is just to draw a straight line. From start of the stroke to the end of the stroke, and wherever it intersects these vertical lines, so you will have to mark them as the intersection points. And the numbering will continue. So this is P8, P9, P10, P11, P12 and of course at the end it is P13. So this will complete our displacement diagram. The next step will draw the cam profile. So I'll start by drawing the base circle, and the dimension is already given to us. Base circle radius is 30 mm. So we'll draw the base circle whose radius 30 mm or diameter of 60 mm. Base circle of diameter 60 mm or radius 30 mm. Now please listen carefully, because the steps are more whenever the follower is oscillating. The steps for construction will be definitely more. So first of all, I need to locate the fulcrum center here. As we have seen in the previous section, how I have drawn a rough sketch of cam and shown you what is the fulcrum center and what is the cam center. So of course, cam center is already located. That is the center of base circle. But I need to locate the fulcrum center as well. So what I'll do is I'll first draw the roller, assuming it to be initial position to be vertical. We are aware of the roller radius as well. Roller radius is given to us as 10 mm. So with that, I've drawn the roller. We also know what is the length of the follower arm, that is 45 mm. Okay. Length of the follower arm is 45 mm. So set the compass for 45 mm. And with this as a center, that is the center of roller, mark it as a center, cut, make an arc of 45 mm. Okay, I'll repeat. To draw the length of the follower arm, which is given as 45 mm, from this point as a center, draw an arc of 45 mm. Next step, the distance between fulcrum center and cam center is 55 mm. So with this point as a center and radius equal to 55 mm, you'll have to cut this arc. Okay, so wherever it intersects, we'll draw a line from this point till here, which is 45 mm, and from this point to this point here, which is 55 mm. So I've got the fulcrum center and cam center at 55 mm. I've got the length of follower arm as 45 mm. So at this particular point, you can just draw the pivot or pin line, not necessary. Let me rub it. It will simply okay. So this point I'm going to name it as Q. I hope this is clear how to locate the fulcrum center, because both the dimensions are given to us, 45 and 55. So I've located point Q. In the next step, I need to draw two more circles. As we have seen in the previous problem, because of the roller, we need to draw one more circle from the roller center. And measurement of all the length will be with respect to that circle. So I'll draw this circle let us call this as prime circle. I'll draw one more circle which will be starting wherein the radius, let me call this as point O. So I'll draw a circle whose radius will be equal to OQ with a center O. So I'm going to stop the circle here. It is continued at the top. Okay. I hope it is clearly visible. Okay, so totally three circles. One is the base circle, 30 mm radius. Next is the prime circle, so that will be 30 plus 10 mm, that is 40 mm radius. And at the end, another big circle with OQ as the radius. Okay, so we have base circle, prime circle, and at the end, a circle which I am going to call it as Q circle, because all the subsequent Qs I am going to mark on this bigger circle. Once you draw these three circles, in the next step I will highlight the rise stroke, dwell stroke and return stroke in the cam profile. Again, listen carefully. I'm going to start measuring the rise stroke from this line, that is OQ. So OQ right now is my reference line. So with respect to OQ, I'll start measuring the rise stroke, return stroke and dwell stroke as it is. So first one is rise stroke of 80 degrees. Okay, just for your understanding, I'll be writing it here. I'll erase it later on. So this is your theta naught. That is a rise stroke. Then we have a dwell stroke. So this portion is theta d, and at the end we are having the return stroke. So this angle is theta r. Okay, so like this you need to divide the circle into rise stroke, dwell stroke and return stroke. I will slightly extend these division lines up till the Q circle. Okay. In the next step, we need to divide the rise stroke into six parts. We need to divide the return stroke also into six parts. I will divide these lines on the Q circle. Okay, so something like this. So I've got it as Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. Q5, Q6, this will be Q7, division of the return stroke, erase this. Q8, Q9, Q10, Q11, Q12 and Q13. So I made 6 divisions in the right stroke, 6 divisions in the return stroke. In the next step, okay, last 2 steps are remaining. Set your compass for exactly 45 mm. Set the compass for 45 mm radius. With Q1 as the center, draw an arc on the prime circle like this. With Q2 as the center, draw an arc on the prime circle. With Q3 as the center, you will get one more arc. With Q4 as the center, you will get one more arc. With Q5 as a center, you will get one more arc. And with Q6 as a center, you will get one more arc. So you will be drawing such 6 arcs. So I will repeat the procedure. You set your compass for a distance of 45 mm, that is length of the arm of the follower. And starting with Q1, draw an arc on the prime circle. Draw an arc on the prime circle. With Q2 as a center, draw an arc on the prime circle. With Q3 as a center, draw one more arc. Similarly with Q4, Q5 and Q6. So you will be getting 6 such arcs here. Okay. So once these arcs are done, all you have to do is, if I want to trace P1, measure the distance between P1 and 1, that is nothing but you will have to set your compass from P1 to point 1. Okay, before that, let me name this. I want to bring this 1 to 13 numbers also here. So, these arcs, wherever you have drawn these arcs on the prime circle, those are nothing but your point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So I want to locate P1, so I will set the compass from 1 to P1 and from 1 to P1 you can cut it over here. So you will get P1. Similarly, from 2 to P2, set the compass or measure this, and from 2 you can cut the corresponding arc to get P2. Similarly, you can get P3. Can get P4, okay, you can get P5 and you can get P6. So for this P1, as a center I will draw the roller whose radius is 10 mm. So what I'll do is I'll just simply draw an arc over here instead of complete roller. Similarly for P2 also I will draw an arc. For P3 we'll draw an arc. For P4, we'll draw an arc. For P5, arc. For P6 also, an arc. And we shall join, starting from this point, all these arcs by a smooth curve. Okay, try to darken this. Little bit different procedure, but this is how you are supposed to get the cam profile curve. Okay, once this is done, then we need to repeat the same procedure for the right stroke, return stroke. Okay, so I hope you can do the same thing for return stroke. I am not going to do this now. The reason being is it will become too shabby and it will lead to confusion. But if you understood how to do this for right stroke, then you can also similarly do it for a return stroke. So all you have to do is start with Q7 with radius of 45 mm. Cut the arc on the prime circle. With Q8, cut the arc on the prime circle. With Q9 also, cut the arc on prime circle and so on up to Q13. On these particular arcs, your numbering will continue as 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and so on. So whenever you want to measure P7, so from 7 to P7 you can measure and cut the arc, and you have to repeat the same procedure. Okay, I'll repeat again. I'm not doing the return stroke because it would lead to lot of shabby drawing and confusion. In your book, while you are drawing, you'll have to ensure that only the final cam profile is with the dark line. Rest all should be thin lines because they are only the construction lines. So your base circle and the cam profile, these two profiles should be thick and dark. Rest all should be thin and light. But on the board, I have to draw each and every line dark so that it is visible to you. That is why it is leading to a lot of confusion if I draw the return stroke also. So I'll stop till here. In case if you are having any doubts, any problems regarding this, you can always contact me, message me or call me, and I'll clear your doubts on this particular. Okay. So this will complete all the types of cam profile construction. Now if you just check out some previous question papers, you can see that sometimes the question is asked for 20 marks along with some additional question. That means if the question is for 20 marks, let us take the same example, then this would be for 8 marks, that is a displacement diagram. The cam profile what you have drawn will be for 10 marks. The total is 18. What about the remaining 2 marks? So for remaining 2 marks, they will be asking you find out the maximum velocity and acceleration of rise and return stroke. Okay, so there is a very simple equation. So if you use simple equation, you can find out maximum velocity and acceleration of rise stroke as well as of return stroke, which I'll be discussing in the next class. So that will fetch 2 marks out of 20 marks to calculate the maximum velocity and acceleration. So there will be totally 4 sets of equations you'll have to remember, because if the rise stroke is of uniform velocity, the formula will be different. If the rise stroke is of SHM, the equation is different. If it is of UARM, the equation is different. If it is of cycloidal, the equation will be different. So like this, 4 sets of equations you'll have to remember, and as per that, if you substitute the data directly, you'll get the maximum velocity and acceleration. So this will cover up in the next class, and also after this we'll be starting with the unit number 5. Okay, in the next class I'll be starting with the unit number 5. Unit number 5, as we have already discussed in the beginning of the class, that it does not have any theory, does not have any numericals, no derivations, and no fixed syllabus. Unit number 5 is totally based on applications, so that we'll discuss in the tomorrow's class.